Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome back to the 343industries.org community forum Let's Play of XCOM 2. My name is Red Star Rocket, and when I left you last time, we were just preparing to deal with the retaliation mission, which you can see over here. Or rather, you should be able to see if we don't get freezing and stuttering. So this is Operation Little Calm in New India, and hopefully this is going to go better than our last mission did, as our last mission was... frankly, it was a disaster. Poor decisions left, right, and centre, and we were very, very lucky to get out with as few injuries as we did. And this time we are going to bother to equip ourselves properly beforehand, because obviously planning and preparation is half the battle in these things, so we'll actually make sure we do that this time. And as a retaliation mission, snipers aren't going to be hugely useful on this, so I hope they enjoyed their run out last time, as they won't be joining us here. And at this point, I think it's all but certain that we are going to run as a berserkers. So we'll be expecting to deal with them as best we can. We may also bring Boss here, simply because it may be useful to have an extra gun around who can also heal, rather than relying purely on defences. Unfortunately, retaliation missions do have quite a lot of enemies that can rush out of the darkness or hide in plain sight, and so we're more likely to take injuries on these things. So I don't think bringing Boss would be a bad idea. Obviously, having Morrigan is nice, but we'll be relying on her pretty much for scouting and scouting only, so we may forgo her just for the duration of this mission and instead bring a slightly more aggressive squad. And indeed, I think we'll definitely bring Slick along. So this will be our squad for this mission, yeah? First things first, we'll make sure everyone is properly armed and equipped. And we do have plasma grenades now, which is always nice. Boss will be getting the medkit. I think we'll probably also give him a battle scanner, just so when he's not healing, he can still fulfill scout duties for us. Slick will be taking the plated vest, as we'll be using him as something of a meat shield. And the skulljack, we probably won't get any use out of that, so there's no point really adding that on. But before we go anywhere this time, we are going to consider our heavy weaponry, as that's something we will be using this time. Now, I'm not entirely sure who I'll put it on. Perhaps one option would be Tyrone, as giving him that extra rocket would be pretty useful. But on the other hand, I am a little tempted to put it on Slick, as that way we'd be giving up a grenade for a rocket launcher effectively, but he'd gain even more resistance to damage, so I think we may try it with him. Here we are, exosuit. And we'll just quickly correct his armour, as unfortunately it does go a little strange when swapping between armour configurations sometimes, but no matter. So with a little luck here, Slick should be starting with 4 points of armour. I'm not quite sure if the exosuit grants an additional 1 or 2 because of his blast panning perk, but at any rate, it should be really, really useful. And if we need someone to take a hit, well, he's our man. We also have the spider suit, which I think grants a bit of increased mobility. And because of that, I would be tempted to put it on T. Although on the other hand, I wouldn't mind it on Kiko either, because Kiko obviously could use the grapple quite well to get extra height advantage for his DMR. Though that said, T can run and gun, so the grapple is a free action, then run and gun will potentially move him a really long distance to a crisis point. So I think we will go with that. And he loses his grenade there, but that's not a huge issue. What is more of an issue is that he appears to have lost most of his limbs there, so we'll just quickly put that right. There we are. We also do have some equipment here, and frankly, I don't find the hair triggers particularly useful, but on the other hand, there's no reason not to use it when we have a spare slot, so we might as well stick that on T. You never know, we might get lucky and get a free shot. I have also checked the promotions, and Bladestorm does appear to trigger after any enemy attacks rather than prior to them. And again, Implacable, with a combination of Run and Gun, Implacable, and the Grapple from the Spider Suit, would be able to get T to move some truly ridiculous distances in combat. And of course, being able to move forward, strike someone, and then fall back to better cover would be incredibly useful. So he will be taking Implacable here. Just check, make sure we don't have any spare equipment here. I think we do. Perhaps we could, perhaps we could give boss a plasma grenade. Actually, we do still have the frost bombs to go out, so perhaps we'll put the frost bomb on Kiko. And we'll give the battle scanner to Blue. And I'm fairly happy with the squad composition here, so without further ado, let's get this on the way. So this is Operation Little Con to stop an elephant retaliation, and it's very difficult, so this should be a lot of fun. I'm expecting to encounter berserkers, I'm not expecting to encounter chrysalids, so we're really going to hope that's how things turn out. As if it's chrysalids, there are things we can do to negate the worst of them, but I'd rather not let it get that far.
Just came down. The aliens have amassed a huge force to strike one of the resistance outposts nearby, and those people desperately need any help we can provide them. We're going in to eliminate the enemy threat and secure the area.
So this is Emancipation Creek in New India. We don't have any intel on the mission site. I assume it'll just be a standard Resistance Haven outpost tile set. We need to rescue at least 6 civilians, which isn't great. I always find the rescuing aspect to be quite stressful, but there we go. So let's see how many of these people we can rescue.
Are attacking the outpost. Eliminate all enemy units and protect those civilians. Advent came in hot and so did we. You won't have a concealed position for deployment on this one.
So obviously this would be a good spot to get some scouting on the map. We don't have any snipers, which is perhaps a bit of a shame, as having snipers with a very, very early vantage point for them is, well, quite a good thing. But it's no big deal. And Slick has hoped has 4 points of armor here, which is great. Really, really great. But let's start with a quick scouting move from Blue. And I'm a little reluctant to advance further than this. Although we could, of course, double move Slick up if need be. As then if anyone were to get shot, it would be him, especially if we were running this slightly weaker cover here. And of course, being a retaliation, we do need to start making progress as soon as possible. But on the other hand, we don't want to reveal anything when we're not in a position to deal with it. So, for the moment at least, actually, I think we're just going to move up a little cautiously.
Order's confirmed. Moving out.
Sir.
Moving to position.
Lock and load, Deltas.
Rolling.
And who has our battle scans? Was it Blue? We'll just quickly see if we can spot what we're up against here. And we can confirm here that at least these 3 civilians are not faceless, otherwise we'd have seen them be revealed there, so that's good. This is potentially four we can pick up quite quickly. And of course, there's no aliens around here, so we might be able to move up just a bit more aggressively. But of course, that's a window, so we should be a little cautious about moving too far.
Heading to that location.
But this spot here is safe, so for now at least, we'll just keep moving everyone forward.
Understood, moving out.
Secure that area.
And that way, we've got people as far forward as possible for our next gen.
Steer clear of those berserkers. They can't do much from range, but they're lethal up close.
And that berserker has just run back into the darkness, which is really bad news for us. That means we have to chase it now. I'd rather hope it would run toward us so we could start putting damage on it, but it's not the end of the world. And of course, the first thing we could do here, perhaps a sensible thing, would be simply to flank this guy with T. Would he have a shot from here? He wouldn't have a shot from here, right. So we've got a choice here. We can either flank this guy with T and take him out nice and easily, or we can try and get on the roof and maybe get some vision on this enemy berserker. Certainly there doesn't seem to be any way for us to get anyone else onto the roof this turn.
Rolling.
And I think we're going to lose someone to this berserker regardless of what we do here, so we may as well just settle and do a little collateral damage here, I think. And you can see already, the advanced grenade launcher provides a huge, huge increase to the blast radius of our grenades, so we'll be putting this to good use as soon as possible. I.e. now.
Catch.
And we'll simply have T flank this guy and take him out. He's even got it as a free action. There we are. I was just deriding that a few moments ago, which is great. And he's got an implacable move, right? So potentially we could even run and gun him up to here. And then maybe even get a shot for that berserker. I think we might try that, you know? You know, I think we're going to do that. I think we're going to go for run and gun here. Let's just hope we don't reveal another pod, of course. And I don't know why that berserker's gone back to there. That seems strange. Anyway, it's not a huge deal, but it is a little odd. And I guess we'll move Kiko up to here and rescue this first civilian and just make certain it's not a faceless, as it's one of the only ones we didn't scan. How far can we throw this? No, that's not good. Right.
Affirmative.
frankly, I'd rather have Boss get this kill, as that way we can put Kiko on Overwatch, and if the Berserker does choose to try and rush us, we might get a couple of shots off against him.
Another kill for the cause.
Secure that area.
Now with Slick, again, I'd like to get a grenade off, but I don't think we're quite going to have the... And how on earth does he have line of sight there? Actually, what we may do, or rather, we would consider doing if Twan wasn't currently standing on it, is blowing out this area here. Simply in order to increase the chances of getting off an Overwatch shot against this guy.
Okay.
For now, though, I think we will just settle for going for a mass Overwatch. But first, we'll try for a quick crit from Twan. It's not great damage, but it's some. Better than nothing. And I think that means it's going to rush that civilian, but there's not a whole lot we can do about that. What we will do, however, is we'll stick Slick over here, rescue the civilian, and hopefully that'll encourage the Berserker to rush at him and make an attack against his hardened armor.
Moving to position. Go! You're safe! Go!
As for Blue, perhaps we'll just pop him up here as well.
Will do.
As we need to start making progress toward the objectives. We still have, or rather should have, one last Overwatch.
Incoming over here.
Or not. But anyway, it looks like the Berserker did make an attack against Slick there, but missed. And it simply didn't display the animation, but more worryingly, it didn't go for this thing. Now, as far as I understand, the whole point of, the enraged status that we saw come up earlier was that they would immediately make an attack against the closest visible target, which suggests to me this thing is a faceless. So I think before we do anything else, we will have a quick battle scanner here. Make sure that this guy's just in range. There we go. And then we'll have a look, and I think that's going to be a faceless. Then it definitely revealed a couple of enemies there. So the one I thought was a faceless wasn't, but we've got one over here which is, and that's good to know. We've also, I think, confirmed that this one is safe, so we've rescued 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That would be enough for us. But we're running close to the end of our recording time here, so we'll put a short break in the video. Please don't go anywhere, and I'll see you in just a moment. Hello, and welcome back. So we've got two targets visible here. I still don't really understand how previously we were apparently able to target clean through this building, but not the other. Perhaps it was simply a UI error. It has been known to happen just on occasion in XCOM. Also worth noting, this exact spot here appears to be safe, the other two do not. So we are quick, you know, this is as good a time as I need to find out if that's true or if I'm about to get someone killed. So let's make this move here. And hopefully this won't reveal that enemy pod. And it has, but that's not a big deal. Slick's got plenty of armor, and more to the point, he can cover bust for us. And we'll just check the... Yeah, that looks to be a reasonably sized explosion. We'll just check the rocket launcher for comparison. And he seems to really be struggling to target that, which is a little odd. So, on this occasion, I think we'll just start with a big grenade. And there, that should be safe to avoid wounding that civilian. There we go. While also putting all those Avan troopers in the open. And let's hope the civilian there is safe. This is fine. Oops. Now, can we get any flares out here, or are they just out of range? They're just out of range, right. It's not really a huge deal. Now, everyone here is in the open. And we could also perhaps use a Hebe's grenade to finish off this... Yeah, we can use this this grenade to finish this Berserker, so let's do that first. As he can't really hurt anyone else. And he's earned himself a promotion, which is even better. Although we have potentially blundered a little here. And as I said before, we can of course use the grapple for T. Just to get him right up to any enemy targets. And it's a free move. It doesn't count towards his move limit, so we may do that. But I think we'll probably move him last. Just once we've ascertained exactly who and what else we're going to be fighting this turn. Kiko as well. We could still use the Mimic Beacon here. That's one option. But let's start actually by taking down this Faceless. And this, yeah, we don't even need to chain shot this, it's just going to die. Although, actually, I'm just looking at these guys' health. I think that's probably going to be a bit risky, actually. Obviously, it'd be nice if we could do the max damage, but that's not guaranteed to kill them, and we need to restart getting guaranteed kills at this point, I think. So let's finish off this Faceless. And that did the absolute minimum damage, but that's fine. That's all it needed to do. And I probably should have... just think about it, actually. I probably should have shot the other guy behind him. Right. I probably should have shot the other guy, as that would have been the one T would have had the best chances to hit.
You are dead.
Any case. Right, let's move T forward. And then once we've worked out our hit odds and things, we'll make decisions about Mimic Beacons and such. And for reasons I can't begin to understand, he allegedly wouldn't be able to hit from there. Okay, this is just plain weird. I have no idea why this isn't counting as a hit, but or that he's not triggering as visible from here. This is some very strange line of sight behavior here.
the designated coordinates.
And there's not even the option to move up and hit him there. This is very, very strange. So for now, I think we are just going to put T here and we'll see if we can get a line of sight on this guy, but I'm not sure quite why that isn't showing up. And certainly I don't know why we can't make a sword attack here. This is just thoroughly, thoroughly strange. So we did get a free action there. So we'll make the free move and then we'll try another attack. Yeah, I don't know why that was happening there. That's very, very odd. But in any case, I appear to have been proved completely wrong about the head trigger at this point. That's twice in a row it's triggered and made things much, much easier for us. So I'm always happy to be wrong when these things happen, put it that way. From this point, I think we are going to put Kiko up here. We know all these civilians here are safe, so potentially we could just rescue the four of them and then set up an overwatch trap and let everyone else come to us. But I feel awkward about that. I don't like the idea of playing with civilians' lives so casually.
Moving.
We also need to be a little careful about the flames spreading down here. And that is a really, really, really worrying pod to have to deal with. That's an extremely heavy pod. And revealed another one as well. So we need to mimic beacon this.
About to get burnt to a crisp. Fire's getting worse here.
Right. And all these soldiers appear to be fine. Right. So we're going to mimic beacon this. Not any point doing anything otherwise.
Affirmative. Moving out.
And Kiko, we're going to... I think we'll just use a full overwatch from him. Although we'll throw the mimic beacon first, then we'll use a full round of overwatch. But first we're going to go for some high explosives. Hopefully we'll bring out the floor from under this mimic beacon as well and wound it. While putting as much stuff in the open as possible.
Grenade out.
And just generally really, really ruining these guys' days. And we really need to just make some progress with Blue here, so we're gonna get him just up here, I think. We'll put him here, so first of all he'll rescue the civilian, and then hopefully whatever rushes the mimic beacon, he'll be able to get off two shots against next turn.
Roger
thanks
that.
To his class power.
Get back to the ship. Moving to designated position.
And we'll see, can we maybe hit something here? Now the odds of this for killing it are good. We've got a 40% chance of killing it, and we need this is functionally about a 79 to an 80% chance of a kill here. Is anything but absolute minimum damage will kill this? So I think we'll take this one out. Just reduce the incoming fire on the mimic beacon, and we've hit it for the minimum necessary damage, which is fine. And I really should have put the axe on T here, but no matter. This is probably, I think, the best option here. Is just shooting anything else likely won't kill it. So while the odds on paper this don't look good, it's functionally a 7 out of 10 chance to kill it, so we're going to go for that. Not great, but not the end of the world. And we'll try and finish off with boss. And he's killed it, which is great.
Another kill for the cause.
And I'm hoping what will happen here is this Berserker is going to run up and try and melee this Codex. Is there anywhere we could put this mode beacon where it would be inside of everything but the Berserker? Let's try that. And I've made a mistake there. Apparently you can't use that along with Overwatch, but never mind. Oh, that was a horrendous mistake. That was a horrendously silly mistake. I have not considered this as well as I should have. But fortunately, T does have that bonus armor. Can he still move while disoriented? Yes, he can. Right. Because what we're going to do is I think we're just going to get a grenade and dump both these guys on the floor, and we can get a hit on the Codex from here as well. And that's killed it outright. Now he's taken quite a bad knock there, and that is a silly decision on my behalf. But there's not a whole lot we can do about that now. And we'll make the implacable move in just a moment. And first things first anyway, we should really take this thing out. So firstly we'll cast a flare on this Berserker. And then we will probably use Slick and just blow it into the open.
I'm on the move. Go on, get out of here.
And allegedly this won't hurt her. Heaver here, so let's give this a try.
Bring in the pain.
And doesn't seem to have hurt him. Certainly the ground under him is intact, and now he does have that shot. But does Kiko have a shot as well? Yes, he does. Now, who do we want to get this kill? Kiko has apparently received a promotion already, so he'll be our first colonel after this. T doesn't have a promotion, but he can't get one. Blue's got one. So really, it's Ty and Boss who could use a promotion each. We're also quickly going to heal T up as a just-in-case measure.
Help him, Delta.
I doubt that this will be needed, but you never know. And in any case, we'll get the final kill with Ty here.
Moving to designated coordinates.
139% chance to hit, that's easy. And we've still got a faceless. So it's potentially a very, very good thing indeed that I healed Twan when I did. Especially as well as we still do have an Overwatch on Kiku as a result. Although we are going to move T just up to here, get him as far away as possible from that thing.
Done.
The default sitting on this rifle still pours a lot of damage on a lot of targets.
And hopefully, Kiko should get a double Overwatch off on this guy, if you can see it. So who do we want to get a promotion here? Really, I think it's Ty.
Ready to rock.
He was promoted last video, of course, but I think so was T. Or was the last video? Was the video before? It might have been the video before, actually. Yeah. So we'll just get Ty to finish this off here, as we want to get him his promotion as soon as possible. Although, actually, very quickly, we are going to just dump one more heal onto T. Is I don't quite know how the wound system works in this. And it might be the case that if we return with full health, it won't be quite so severe. In any case, we have plenty of ways we can deal with this. And I think a guaranteed kill is probably the best one of them. Unless we want to get it on Slick, actually. I can't remember when he was last promoted, but giving him a kill might be an option.
Moving to designated quarters.
Just to ensure that we're putting as much high explosive on this thing as possible. And given this isn't a guaranteed kill, we might as well take it. In any event, it's more
target
than
neutralized.
Enough.
Menace 1-5, status confirmed. We're not picking up any additional contacts. The AO is clear. Status confirmed. Mission accomplished.
By and large, I'm really happy with that mission, which is a nice comeback from the last one. Obviously, I made one incredibly silly decision with the Mimic Beacon there. Incredibly silly. But that is the kind of thing that happens. You've got to be prepared for it. And overall, that's simply a moment of madness rather than a really stupid decision. So, that's not really the end of the world. And we'll just be careful in future as well. We'll make sure that we understand that enrage means it's going to hit the the nearest XCOM offered if it sees, rather than going for a civilian, apparently. So, I don't know, maybe it gives it the functional equivalent of run and gun or something. In any case, silly decision, we'll learn from it next time, and I'm not going to beat myself over that too much. Especially as we did save a, frankly, extremely large number of civilians. It's also nice to see here that, regardless of being wounded, T was really pulling his weight there. I think he made something like 2 double hair trigger shots, which is, you know, the chances of that are, what, 100 to 1 in the mission? Something like that? It's really, really good at any rate. So, happy with that. And of course, we do have some promotions.
Morale is sure to be high after an operation like that. Great work, Commander.
Sadly, T is gravely wounded, but again, in 8 days, that's not quite so bad. And we do have our first colonel now. In any case, we are slightly over our recording time now, so there'll be a short break in the video. Just once we've seen the stuff we've recovered. And then we'll do soldier promotions after the break. So, first things first, we've recovered a berserker corpse here, so long after the massive berserker has expired, its chemical pumps continue to forcefully inject powerful stimulants and painkillers into its lifeless body. And of course, we've unlocked the berserker autopsy, so This unusual specimen is clearly afflicted by some form of extreme muscular hypertrophy, although how the species came to exist in this state will require a thorough examination. I suspect the research could lead to varying enhancements for our own troops, perhaps even some means of intensifying their own thirst for combat.
Considering the limited resources available to you, Commander, you have still managed to exceed my expectations. Excellent work.
And we've gained bonus supplies in Asia, which is just in time for the supply drop, I think, so that's really nice. So, there'll be a short break in the video here. Don't go anywhere, and I'll see you in just a moment to upgrade our soldiers. Hello and welcome back. So we've got a couple of soldiers to promote here. Blue, I think we'll do him first. Weapon upgrade, that'll just be the scope, we'll come back and do that in a minute. But first, promotions. So, deep reserves or escape and evade. Deep reserves, when damaged, heal 50% of the damage over time, max 2 health per turn, 8 health total. Reduces wound recovery time after missions by 50%, that's good. That's very, very good in fact. But on the other hand, escape and evade could be really, really useful just if we want to, you know, basically move up and scout something in a hurry. Or, if, you know, in a pinch we could use it as a spotter for snipers. We could move Hebe forward after escaping and evading him, have him spot something, put him on Overwatch, or whatever, and that way we'd have a really, really nice, easy time of things. But perhaps most importantly of all, of course, is the fact that, if nothing else, it does mean that if he's ever in real, real trouble and needs to escape from a bad situation, we could simply throw that on him, so... I think this is one of the ones where normally I would probably pick deep reserves, as I've generally disparaged the regular tree, perhaps very unfairly, well, definitely very unfairly given Kiko's Overwatches, but deep reserves is probably the one I'd naturally pick here. But that is a very, very low detection radius. So I think perhaps we'll go with escape and evade here. I'm sure I can find a use for it, put it that way. And then we'll do our first major, or rather our first colonel. So at the moment he has 79 plus 10 aim, which is 80 plus 10, so that function is going to give him, what, potentially, I think, 110 aim if he's got the high ground, and that's before we even begin to account for range modifiers from his DMR. He also has really, really high willpower, which is great. So, fire for effect. Guarantee a hit on all targets in your line of fire by spending extra ammo, may not crit. Now, is that an area of effect thing? Is that an area of effect thing, or does it just mean you shoot at everyone in your line of sight? Let's have a look. On all targets in the line of fire. So maybe it's you pick one target and then everything between you and it within a small corridor is hit as well. Not guaranteed to crit, but it's only one action point. And it costs 2 ammo, but again, it does have expanded magazines, so that's not a big deal. Explosive action. Gain an extra action point immediately in exchange for losing an action point at a later time. I think that's one that I'm not sure about. That one seems quite situational. So you get a free action point, but you lose an action point in your next turn. Right. That one I'm not so sure about, if I'm honest. Obviously the extra action point is good, but then... See, weirdly, I'd say this explosive action might work better with the Overwatch perks, simply because this way, you know, if you lose your actions or whatever, you could potentially get, what, 4 Overwatch shots in a turn, plus, I think, 4 points of armor. I don't know. I'm not sure what to do with this one. quite a difficult choice, really. I think just because it is in the regulatory and that's what Kiko specified, we're going to go with fire effect. But my inclination here would be to go with this one anyway, regardless of which way I was building it. Although, then again, specifically with the regulatory explosive action, precisely because of this established defenses perk, that seems like that would synergize really, really, really well with explosive action, so... I think we'll go with fire for effect, just for now. But normally I think if I were to do an Overwatch build class, I'd probably use explosive action. But anyway, Kiko, if you'd prefer that we try that one, send me a message or leave a comment and we'll make decisions then. We've also got T, who is wounded for 8 days and... a little frustrating, but there we go. I'm sure he'll have recovered well enough by the time we get back, put it that way. Alien alloys and illyrium crystals, but I think we'll just finish off building the radio really and then we'll go grab that.
Setting course for Sector 11, West Africa.
We're reading you.
There we go. And we've earned the continent bonus as well, which is nice. So let's move over here. We'll grab the alien wreckage and then... Do we want another engineer? Probably, actually, but... I think right now, this might be of more benefit to us. As Illyrium is very, very rare.
Avenger plotting new course.
And while having an engineer would be a nice thing, you need to be taking every opportunity you can to get Illyrium, really. Especially when you're doing things like researching power armor.
Thanks, Commander. The new workshop will do just fine.
So we'll equip one engineer here, and that means that we can use gremlins to staff adjacent facilities. So we'll probably put a resistance comms up here or something. But for now, we'll pop a... Actually, I don't know what we do here. We can probably empty and that's annoying me. It's not granting that. Never mind. For some reason, the UI can be a little buggy, let's say, when it comes to this sort of thing, but never mind. Next thing will be to begin excavating the last of the debris and... Down here would gain some supplies, but over here would gain some Illyrium. And of course, the exposed power point will be really, really good because it means we can essentially staff the Shadow Chamber for no energy cost, and that'll be our next building thing. So we're going to go for that. And there's only 7 more days until this is done, so by that point, we'll be able to bring this down and make it a bit quicker. And there we are, we're done with that room now. So we'll just have one more engineer over here. And that should be done fairly soon, and then we'll put up the Shadow Chamber. Because by the time that's finished, we'll have the supply drop. So we'll collect the alien wreckage, we'll grab the supply drop, and then we'll start doing a bit more excavating. Alloy potting, not the nicest thing in the world, truth told, but it could be a lot worse.
Incoming message for you, Commander. Patching it through to your quarters now.
You have made considerable progress against the aliens over the past month, Commander. I hope that your ongoing efforts will only lead to further success.
We've made nearly 500 supplies that month, so that's really good. Avatar Project, not so bad. Alien Infiltrator, we'll definitely be taking this one. That's far too much of a pain in the arse to be dealing with, put simply. And we'll get the supplies just as soon as we finish the wreckage here.
Strategic resource located.
So this is alien wreckage. Initial reconnaissance of the area indicated extensive casualties from both sides, along with a slew of alien wreckage left behind during the invasion. We used our onboard sensors to scan for salvage and were able to recover valuable equipment to further our own projects. So perhaps this is even some wreckage from the First War.
Avenger plotting new course.
And then once this is done, that machinery should be cleared. And we'll be able to just move in, start building that shadow chamber. But first things first, we have a mission coming up. So this is to recover a scientist and some intel, which is great. Really, really great, as a matter of fact. We're getting a little low on scientists at the moment, and we're wanting to put up a lab as soon as possible, so perhaps that'll be an option. So this is to recover Dr. Kalina Popova in Operation Forgotten Palace, and we're rescuing them from an advent vehicle, presumably some sort of prison transport. So I hope you'll join me for that next time we take on Operation Forgotten Palace. Until then, my name has been Red Star Rocket. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you again next time. Until then, take care and good night.